Hi, I'm Chuck Mills. Welcome to Virginia Time Travel. We here at Virginia Time Travel have been working on an exciting new book called Alexandria 1861 to 1865, which for the first time captures the look of Alexandria and Northern Virginia at the time of the Civil War. Exploring the photo vaults of the Library of Congress, and delving into the treasures of two private photo collections under the custodianship of Alexandria Library's Special Collections Branch, we have unearthed some remarkable finds. So let's go back in time and talk about what it was like to be a civilian in Northern Virginia during the Civil War. And let's take a look at some of the actual photographs taken during that turbulent period. In the 1850s, Alexandria was the commercial center for all of Northern Virginia and boasted a busy waterfront, a commercial canal, and expanding railway traffic. Alexandria was growing rapidly, and between 1850 and 1860, its population grew from 8,700 to over 12,500. Alexandria took great pride in being the hometown of George Washington. It was on the steps of Gadsby's Tavern that Light Horse Harry Lee declared Washington first in war, first in peace, first in the hearts of his countrymen. Alexandria, with its long history of service to the Union, initially opposed secession, and many citizens would gladly have remained in the Union or remained neutral, but were prepared to cast their lot with the Confederacy if it came to war. The tide turned towards secession on April the 12th, 1861, when South Carolina fired on Fort Sumter and Mr. Lincoln called for 75,000 volunteers to crush the rebellion. Our first picture is Alexandria at the outbreak of the war, taken from the riverside. The decade of the 1850s was turbulent. The nation was increasingly polarized. The Compromise of 1850 outlawed the slave trade in the District of Columbia, but the Fugitive Slave Act infuriated Northerners by guaranteeing the rights of slave owners to reclaim slaves who escaped to the North. Isabel Emerson of Alexandria declared, "Virginia is trying to hold on to the Union. I don't know whether I'm a secessionist or not, but if this dear old state secedes, I shall too." One of Alexandria's most famous citizens, Robert E. Lee, was in Alexandria on April the 21st, 1861, at church. That evening, he received a note from a representative of the governor of Virginia asking him to meet with the governor in Richmond the next day. Lee went to Richmond and accepted appointment as commander of the military and naval forces of Virginia. We next have a picture of the Marshall House. This was a hotel, a large hotel, stands on King Street. In April 1861, a huge Confederate flag was raised on a 30-foot pole atop the Marshall House. This flag could be seen in Washington, and it could be seen in the White House. The Washington Herald reported that Senator Wade, upon observing it with a glass from the president's room, expressed his regret to Mr. Lincoln that it should be tolerated, to which President Lincoln replied that he did not think it would wave long. Things were very tense. Everyone knew war was coming. D.G. Duncan, confidential agent of the Confederate Secretary of War, reported on May the 2nd, 1861. "Great excitement here. Troops expected from Washington at any time. Alexandria unprepared to oppose attack. Merchants here moving goods, furniture, and families to the country." Well, long before dawn, on the morning of May the 24th, 1861, 8 Union regiments crossed the Potomac River to seize Alexandria and Arlington Heights. By 2 o'clock in the morning, a large luminous moon shimmered over the river as the federal longboats touched their oars into the muddy waters. For an hour, muffled oars pulled against the river. The red-trousered New York Zouaves sat tensed in silent anticipation. They docked quickly and quietly unloaded into the deserted streets of Alexandria. The entrance of the Federals was unopposed. Colonel Elmer Ellsworth led his men down the empty streets until he came to the Marshall House flying its Confederate flag. Ellsworth, followed by his soldiers, went inside, hurried to the roof, and with a knife borrowed from a private soldier, cut down the emblem of rebellion. Ellsworth started back for the street with the flag tucked under his arm. But then, in a shadowy hallway, he met the proprietor of the inn, James Jackson. Jackson produced a shotgun and killed Ellsworth on the spot, and was himself cut down within seconds by Corporal Francis Brownell, one of Ellsworth's Zouaves. War had come to Virginia. Here we have a rendition, an artist's rendition, of the death of Colonel Ellsworth. Ellsworth had organized a company of Zouaves, troops known for their exotic Algerian-inspired costumes. They had performed at the White House in 1860. Well, Ellsworth was no stranger to the White House. He had been an election aide of Abraham Lincoln, and he was, in many people's view, like a son to President Lincoln. Lincoln was very upset by the young man's death and staged an elaborate funeral for him at the White House. We next have a picture, another artist's rendition of the murder of Ellsworth. Ellsworth may have had some inkling of what was coming, because he wrote his parents shortly before the invasion, "I am inclined to the opinion that our entrance to the city of Alexandria will be hotly contested. Whatever may happen, cherish the consolation that I am engaged in the performance of a sacred duty." Colonel Wilcox, one of the Union officers, reported, "Alexandria is ours, but I regret to say Colonel Ellsworth has been shot by a person in a house." We next have a picture of the Marshall House. Colonel Ellsworth became a cult figure in the North. Sermons, editorials, songs, and poems praised the hero. Babies, streets, and even towns were named after him. At Lisbon in the Army soared. A New York regiment called Ellsworth Avengers quickly filled, and Corporal Brownell, Ellsworth's true avenger, was lionized and promptly promoted from corporal to second lieutenant in the regular army. One Ellsworth admirer, Alfred Billard of the 5th New Jersey Infantry, wrote, "Disembarking, we marched up King Street and halted at the Marshall House where Colonel Ellsworth had been shot. The stairs on which Ellsworth was shot had been taken away piecemeal. Walls broken, carpets carried off bit by bit, and the flagstaff demolished." We next have a picture of the headquarters of General John Slough on St. Asaph Street.